Okay, welcome to back. Today I am going to discuss shelf life of cut flowers. So that will be under the introduction to floriculture. So we can see the cut flowers. What is the use? Use of cut flowers is for warm welcome. So we can offer the VIPs or any guest, any dignitaries to welcome. So we can offer cut stem, bouquet, etc. And also in the some scientific conferences, seminars, social occasions, we can also decorate the event with the use of cut flowers and cut foliage. So these flowers were sent from an online ordering services. How are they cared for while they travel? So how are they cared for when they arrive? So we can say, now you understood how important these cut flowers. These cut flowers we use to offer. Okay. So, and in other hand, you know, cut flowers are highly perishable in nature. So to keep fresh for long time, that is should be our prime objective. For example, you are producing hair and you want to sent your cut flowers in metro cities, or also would you like to export to other countries? So how we can maintain the freshness of these cut flowers for long time? So in international market or domestic market in metro cities, we can fetch very good returns from produced cut flowers. So in this one, from your shop, if somebody placed the online order, so we have to supply the cut flowers or bouquet, etc. So how we can keep these flowers for fresh for long time, so we can deliver our produce as fresh. So that is very important for customer satisfaction. And what can we do to maintain the fresh cut flowers? So here, fresh cut flower requirements. So even after being cut, flowers still photosynthesize. So I mean the live plants on the tree. You know very well photosynthesis process is continuing. So when we harvest, so after harvesting, we will keep our cut flowers in the storeroom. So not only that cut flower attached with the mother plant, is only that time photosynthesis continues. So we can see after cut of flowers from the mother plant, their photosynthesis process is continued. So requirements. So photosynthesis as well as transpiration, both the physiological reactions occurs continuous. So requirements, number one, high water quality. So water quality is plays very important role. So we can say keep turgid levels up. So we can say the to maintain the freshness of flowers stem and also containing the some leaves, turgidity should be maintained properly. So what we can do for this, once we harvested the cut blooms from the mother plant, immediately we should keep in the bucket of water. Lowerstein. So we can say the uptake of moisture from the water should be continued. Okay. So that water temperature should be at room temperature. And what we can do? After harvesting finished, we have to bring the all produce at store room for preparation. So during the preparation process, we have to make recut, because during the first cut, it will flow the some cell set. So that can cause the blockage of vascular bundles. So maybe uptake of water can affect. So that's why we have to make recut. So that should be half to 1 centimeter above of the previous cut. So this is very important to keep turgidity level of the cut stem or cut flowers. Then not too acidic or alkaline. So you know the pH meter is 0 to 14 and 7 is neutral. So I am in terms of the water quality, water not too acidic or too alkaline. So it is better if that water is close to neutral. So neutral is 7. So we can say around 6.5 to 7 is the best pH of water to maintain the freshness of cut flowers. Not too hard or soft. So I mean the water TDS or EC of that water, not too high or not too low. So we can say water not hard, not soft. It should be normal. Low salinity, measurement of the total dissolved units, that is the TDS. Number two, food and sugar. So we can say sugar is a type of carbohydrate, and that provide the energy to cut flowers or cut stems or also for the cut greens. So sugar plays very important role. So in this, what we can use? We can use the sucrose, and also we can use the dextrose. So from stored sugar or floral preservatives, sucrose in cut flower industry, for especially post harvest handling of cut flowers, sucrose plays very important role. So when we do the treatment of sucrose or sugar to the cut flowers, that is known as pulsing. So we can say around 20% solution of sucrose we have to prepare, and we have to dip the base part of the cut flower, so that can uptake the carbohydrate. So that will work as a source of energy. Okay. And also it will work as floral preservatives. So I mean the our cut flowers we can keep fresh for long time. Healthy environment. So healthy environment is also very important to keep cut flowers fresh. So in this one, fresh air, so no ethylene. So I mean the, you know, ethylene is a gaseous hormone. So this plays very crucial role on the quality of cut flowers. So what happens in this? So if ethylene evolution is too high, so that will deteriorate the quality of cut flowers. So in this, you will notice the faded of the color of the petals, and also it will cause the senescence in cut flowers. So in case of the healthy environment, we should try to reduce the ethylene level to keep our cut flowers fresh for long time. Then conditioning, preparation of materials for arranging by allowing adequate solution uptake. So in conditioning, we can say we have to treat to maintain the adequate solution. So when we will keep the cut stem or cut flowers in that solution, so uptake of the nutrients as well as the moisture or water, it will be continued. Then we can expect our cut flower will remain fresh for long time. So warm water we can see the at room temperature. So we can say cool water is not good, no cold water or no boiling water. So if we are using the water to keep the cut flowers, it should be warm enough. So water uptake will be increased in that, and we can maintain the freshness of cut flowers for long time. Recut flowers and defoliate below the water line. So I mean, if we are keeping the cut flowers in the water solution, say how many leaves are dipping in the water, so those leaves we have to remove. That is known as defoliation. And also the base of cut, we have to make recut. Already I told you, because in first cut, it will flow the cell shape, and that can cause the blockage of vascular bundles. So it will affect the uptake of nutrients and moisture from the water solution. So recut is very important, and that should we do with the sharp knife, and that should be around 1 to 1.5 to 1 centimeter above the previous cut. Okay, so we can get the opening of the vascular bundles. Then hardening full of water after conditioning. So hardening, we can say the treatment with the some solutions, etc. After all these plants are placed in cool place. Sanitation. Provides long lasting flowers. Keep hands, tools, knives, shears, containers and work areas clean. So we can say sanitation is very important. Sanitation means that particular area should be microbes free. So we have to clean regularly, and also we can use the alcohol, etc. And also during the handling of cut flowers, we should treat our hands with the ethanol or spray, etc., or any alcohol. And also we are using the other tools like knives, secateurs, shears, any other containers. So all these things should be sterile before use. So we can keep our cut flowers free from microbes. And microbes like fungus, bacteria also spoil the cut flowers. So it is very important to clean the whole area, as well as tools, as well as our hands, during the preparation of cut flowers. And these are the basic needs of fresh cut flowers. So in this one, number one, high quality water. So in this one, proper pH of 3 to 4.5, low total dissolved salts, etc., poor sugars, supplemented in the preservative solutions. So we can use the sugar as well as sucrose, etc. That will work as a source of energy. And healthy environment, that is clean air and proper temperature. Temperature also plays very important role, because if temperature is too high, then respiration rate will be high. So that will break down the stored food material, and that will affect the shelf life of cut flowers. And clean air, I mean, in that area, if microbes are present, that will infect the cut flowers and it will spoil. So cleanliness of the area is very important. Sanitation provide clean water, use clean tools. So we can say the, if we are using the water, that is very important input material, so that should be free from any contamination. And regarding the tools, if you are using any tools, so those tools we have to sterile with the alcohol spirit or any other material before use. Then deterioration begins. Deterioration and death. So deterioration begins as soon as the flower is cut. Humans must provide the needs, senescence. So in previous slides, I told you, evolution of the ethylene gas, that deteriorate and that will cause the senescence. So we should try to reduce the level of ethylene gas during the handling, packing or packaging, etc. Then we can prolong the shelf life of cut flowers. Causes of deterioration. Causes of deterioration is genetic life. So each flower is pre-programmed. Want to achieve maximum life. Flower life is fun. Day lily 1 day, Dutch iris 3 to 5 days, roses 5 to 7 days, carnation 10 to 14 days, and chrysanthemum 14 to 21 days. So I mean the genetic life of cut flowers will depend on crop to crop. So you are looking here on this slide, day lily is shortest genetic life, that is only 1 day. Or if we are talking for the chrysanthemums, then around 2 to 3 weeks. So we can say 14 to 21 days. But this is the genetic life. But by using the certain floral preservatives, preparation practices, and also other treatments, we can prolong these shelf life of these cut flowers. Causes of deterioration. Number 2, wilting. So excessive water loss or lack of absorption is prime reason of wilting. So we can say in case of the excessive water loss, that is if a storage temperature is too high, then transpiration rate will be high. So that will lose the excess water, and also sometimes it can cause the lack of absorption. So I mean the your cut flower or cut green is not absorbing the moisture properly. So that may be due to blocked vascular tissues. So what are these vascular tissues? Vascular tissues are xylem and phloem. So already I told you, when we will make the cut on the cut flowers or cut greens, it exudes the cell sap and due to lignin that can cause the blockage of vascular tissues. That's why we need the recut to open the vascular tissues or vascular bundles. Then transpiration and respiration, water loss process of plants, that is known as transpiration, and avoid drafts and over handling. So these one, the we have to reduce the respiration and continue the transpiration. If transpiration process is continued, then that cut flower or cut grain will uptake the water from the solution. Or we have to reduce the respiration, because high respiration rate can deteriorate the quality of cut flowers. Stem blockage, so this one is the most common cause. No water movement and can occur. So that already I told you. So that's why we need to recut. And third reason, timing of harvest, time of day. So never cut in heat of the day. So I mean, the if you are doing the cut flower harvesting, as well as also if you are plucking the loose flowers in the field, so that never do during the hot day. That should be do early in the morning during the cold time, low temperature. So it can maintain the freshness. Cut evening, done photosynthesis, done photosynthesis for the day. Early morning, full of water. So I mean, the in evening we can do the watering and early morning we can do harvesting. Then we can see full turgidity of cut flowers or cut stems. Stage of flowering, just before flower is fully open. So stage of flowers also very important in this. It will depend on crop to crop. For example, in red roses, when flower bud is tight but showing slightly colors, that time we can harvest. If we will talk for the gladiolus, then we can see the lower florets fully open and rest are in the process of opening, that time we can harvest. So if we are harvesting at proper stage, then we can extend the shelf life of cut flowers. Ethylene gas, so ethylene is naturally produced gas. So it is very important for aging of plants. It can cause the senescence. It can reduce the shelf life of flowers. So for that, we should try to reduce the ethylene level. Cyanes, fallen petals, dropped florets, and yellowing leaves. These are the common signs. So we can easily identify what is the problem in this harvest.
हम आपस में पे खत्म कर देंगे ठीक।
Okay, good morning everybody. Today I am going to discuss the cultivation of chrysanthemum. So however, chrysanthemum in Hindi is known as Guldaudi, and chrysanthemum is also known as the queen of Ottoman. So chrysanthemum is very important cut flower crop. So in this, the wide range of colors available. So however, chrysanthemum is two types. One is annual and other is perennials. So annual chrysanthemum is Chrysanthemum indicum, and perennials Chrysanthemum morifolium, Dendranthema grandiflora, etc. And this Chrysanthemum belongs to family Asteraceae, that came from the aster. So old name of this family is Compositae, and the characteristics of this family is, in this family Asteraceae, flower arrangement is two types. On the periphery is ray florets, and in the center is disc florets. And Chrysanthemum is originated from the northern hemispheres in China, and this is a very beautiful cut flower crop, and this is also known as the national flower of Japan. So usage of chrysanthemum, so number one is cut flowers, loose flowers, portmums, hanging baskets, beddings, and border plants. So chrysanthemum flowers we can use in different cut flowers. So in cut flowers, long stems, more petals, and opening slowly. So in this is classification is Raj of chrysanthemum. So majority of flowers we use as a cut flowers that we use to prepare the bouquets and for flower arrangement. So chrysanthemum is a short-day plant. So normally we do planting in June, July, and that plant is ready for flowering in September, October. So we can say the flower bud induction is occurs in September, October, and it bloom the October, November, December, and January. So we can say the particularly short days conditions. So this is a very important winter season cut flower crop. And loose flowers. So in loose flowers, we can say the stemless, and their shelf life is also short. So these flowers we can use for offering to gods and goddess, garland making, and the petals of these flowers we can use for rangoli making. So we can decorate the flowers, etc. Portmums. So chrysanthemum we can also grow in the pots as a pot plants for beautification of surroundings, hanging baskets. So in hanging gardens, we can also grow the chrysanthemums. Bedding. So I mean the lawns, etc. Or in our home gardens, we can grow the different varieties of chrysanthemum in beds as a bedding plants. And border plant, a kind of aging we can grow as a border plant. So different bases of chrysanthemum classification. See, it's number one is the inflorescence, number two photoperiod, and number three is temperature. So classification based on inflorescence. So based on the inflorescence, chrysanthemum is classified in total 12 groups: single, anemone, corian, double, decorative, compound, incurved or incurving, reflexed, quill, fuji, and spider. So all these type chrysanthemums have unique characteristics so that you can study in detail in the TK Bose textbooks. Then classification based on the temperature. So based on the temperature, chrysanthemums are three types: thermopositive, thermonegative, and thermozero. So number one is thermopositive. So in this low temperature between 10 to 27 degrees Celsius, inhibit or delay the bud initiation. So low temperature between 10 to 27 degrees Celsius, inhibit or delay the bud initiation, which occur more consistently at 16 degrees Celsius. High temperature over 27 degrees Celsius accelerates bud initiation but delay flowering. So in thermopositive, in this group chrysanthemums, when temperature is low, in between 10 to 27 degrees Celsius, in that range of temperature, these chrysanthemums inhibit or delay the flowering or flower bud initiation. But when temperature is high, over 27 degrees Celsius, these chrysanthemum varieties accelerates bud initiation. So we can say the bud initiation starts. So this delay in flowering. Then thermonegative. Thermonegative indicates when temperature is low, chrysanthemum varieties responds. So we can say in thermopositive varieties only flower bud initiation occurs when temperature is high. But in thermonegative varieties, bud initiation occurs at low temperature to high temperature, we can say the in between 10 to 27 degrees Celsius. But when temperature goes high, then bud initiation delays and also the bud development delays. Then third category, thermozero, flowering occurs at any temperature between 10 and 27 degrees Celsius. So more consistently, a day 27 degrees Celsius and temperature 10, and night 10 degrees Celsius. So we can see the in thermopositive variety response for bud, flower bud initiation or flower development when temperature is high, but thermonegative varieties when temperature is low, and in thermozero, that is the temperature are neutral, Okay, so no major effect of temperature. So then important cultivars. So in this major two groups, standard and spray. So standard varieties of chrysanthemums are Snowball, Snowdon White, and Mountaineer, Sonar Bangla, Bright Golden, Annie, Layman's, Sonali Tara, Purnima, Tata Century, Thai Ching Queen, etc. Okay, good morning everybody. This is Dr. Rajendra Maurya, and today I am going to discuss about institutional gardens. So what are the institutional gardens? So number one garden, you know, a piece of land. By using the hardscapes and softscapes, we beautify that. So we can say the nearby any institute, if surrounding area, we are beautifying by using of plant materials, is known as institutional gardens. So in institutional garden, the institutions include both public or private institutions like hospitals, government and private offices, courts, auditorium, cinema halls, hotels, and so on. So public buildings are often expected to be formal, even and monumental in their design and setting, and they require special aesthetic treatments. So we can say, however, different types of institutions, but particularly for public institutions, we should expect that gardens should be formal in design and monumental in their designs. So proper placement and arrangement of institutional buildings are gaining importance in the modern world, and it is now realized that an institutional building is not complete until the walks, drives, lawns, and recreational areas are properly developed in the compound. So we can say that in any institutional gardens, these features are very important. So without developing these features, that garden is incomplete. So features are walks. We can see the walkways, driveways for vehicles, and lawn area is also important. So in the free time, we can enjoy, we can sit on the lawn. And also in the institutional gardens, a recreational area is also very important. For example, in schools, college campuses, universities, the recreational area is very important, so students and staff can enjoy during the free time. So This is very important part in institutional gardens. So the modern method requires a large area of ground for proper landscape development. For landscape development, open area can be divided into two well-defined areas. So first, the portion of the ground adjacent to the building, and second, the remainder of the area, usually at the rear of the building, should be developed for recreation. So we can say recreation is very important, and we are giving the more emphasis recreational part as well as the lawn area. Other than walkways and driveways is also important part, particularly for institutional gardens. And in the first area, that of public portion of the grounds, the driveways and walks should be primarily structured in order to give quick access from the points of approach to the entrance of the building. So we can see the in any institution, from the point of entrance, main entrance, to the approaching of that particular building, administrative or academic building. So for that, to reach at the parking, we should have the proper driveways. And for the academic building, as well as the administrative part or auditoriums, we should have the direct approach by walkways. So these are the very important part. And planting treatment of the institutional ground should be simple. So in institutional gardens, for planting of trees, shrubs, vines, or seasonal plants should be very simple on the ground. So the institutional building is usually large, and hence it is better to rely upon a fewer number of specimens of sufficient size to establish a proper relation between the planting and the type of building. So we can say the institutional garden, we should have the fewer number of specimens or of sufficient size to establish proper relationship between the planting and the building. Or you can say proper relationship between the softscape and the hardscape. So here, softscape is plantings and hardscape the building. So selection of trees and their location should depend upon the architectural style of the building and by requirements of the same. So based on that architectural style of the building, we have to select the trees and shrubs, and we have to put at proper location so we can enjoy the beauty. So trees and shrubs with fruits and nuts with dangerous thorns should not be used. So we can say the particularly in institutional gardens, trees or shrubs that bears the edible fruits or nuts, we never consider in that garden, and also never use the plants that bears the dangerous thorns, and also we have to avoid the brittle trees. That brittle trees means the those plants, they are easily breakable. So development of the recreational area is very important in institutional planning. The recreation area is generally kept at the back of the building, or if sufficient areas exist by the side of the building, this can also be utilized for the purpose. And recreation areas are planted with trees after careful consideration. So this one is the very important. A recreational area is very important in institutional gardens. So use of shade trees is restricted to the borders of the area, away from the land used for game courts and the athletic fields. So game courts and athletic fields should be away from the main buildings. For a playground, however, it is advisable to plant shade trees so that the games equipment can be set up the shade. So we can say the playground. So if you are putting some game equipments,